Welcome back to Curious Archive. This video is the second part of a series exploring the incredible speculative evolution project of Serina, the world of birds. Serina was created by Dylan Bajda, an exceptional artist and world builder. I have links below where you can follow and support his work. When we left off, Serina was just beginning to warm at the end of the Cryocene era. Now it is the Thermocene, a hothouse world of rising sea levels and increasing volcanic activity that has led to some extinctions, especially within the warming oceans, where large animals like the bloons have sadly died out. In much of the world, however, newly evolved species are enjoying this new climate. 100 million years into this grand experiment, birds have evolved to fill virtually every niche this moon has to offer. In the warm forest, a descendant of the Serilops of the Cryocene ambles through the woods. Their feathers have become coats of short fuzz, and their beaks have given way to fleshy snouts. Indeed, these creatures look quite a bit like the non-avian dinosaurs of old. In size and behavior, however, the animals are almost analogous to an earth deer. Elsewhere in the warm forests, the Serilops have become the more specialized horned omnivores known as the ornitheres. The beaks of these animals are now little more than incisors, within an almost mammalian-looking snout. And in the canopy above, flightless, monkey-like mucks swing from the branches, which, despite their size, are actually an offshoot of the massive Cryocene Serostriders. But the larger Serostriders are still with us in the Thermocene, just changed since we last saw them. Pachyderm Serostriders are huge, armored titans that have traded in their feathers for defensive spikes. Later in the Thermocene, some Serostriders would specialize further, becoming heavily armored goliaths called cragbacks. These bony plates help the animals deter large predators, primarily the tyrant Serins, bone-crushing hunters who have endured beyond the Cryocene. In this age of dinosaur-like megafauna, one might be paying little attention to the achievements of the mudwickets, which are now called the trippets and have become truly terrestrial fish. Fully independent from the water, the trippets have spread out into the jungles, with their tails specializing into a fully functional foot. This strange tripod-like walking strategy isn't perhaps the most efficient just yet, but evolution is blind and the trippets are making it work. Another easily overlooked group from the later Thermocene are the bumblets, small quadrupedal burrowers. At only 7 inches in length, these tiny tunnelers don't appear destined for greatness, but times will soon change. Elsewhere during the Thermocene, the waters, largely empty of megafauna due to Cryocene extinctions, now represent a unique opportunity for any species brave enough to venture into the depths. For example, gigaducks are a type of serostriders that have become semi-aquatic, adopting the webbed feet and lake-paddling lifestyle of ducks on Earth, just on a much larger scale, as gigaducks weigh up to a ton. Since newborn gigaducks have trouble foraging in deep waters, mother gigaducks care for their chicks during their development, often carrying them on their back. In deeper waters, you can find the porpoises, a highly varied classification of aquatic birds. These sleek swimmers evolved later than the bloons, which is why they weren't wiped out by the Cryocene extinctions. The overall body shape and flipper-derived fins make some porpoises resemble penguins, whereas the larger ones seem similar to a porpoise or dolphin. In the depths of the oceans, the sword whales now flourish, gigantic descendants of Cryocene sword sharks. These giants now have larger mouths that allow them to feed upon vast schools of plankton and reach incredible sizes. While these sword whales are gentle giants, the gigadon, a variety of sword whales, are decidedly not. These orca whale-sized predators don't just possess sharp jaws, but also unusually keen minds for fish. They use these large brains to coordinate pack hunting, aided by the reflective markings on their skin that they can use, incredibly, as a form of basic communication. Elsewhere in the depths, we have the less intelligent and far less elegant-looking lumphead grumpus, a creature that might have the best name of anything on Serina. These slow-moving mollusk eaters have evolved elongated fin-like structures on their faces that help them navigate the pitch-black waters while they search for food. A very unique-looking species indeed. Leaving the waters, the isolated Cryan Islands have also changed quite a bit since our last visit. The islands themselves are smaller due to erosion and rising sea levels, and have become more tropical in climate. And the species populating these islands have also become far stranger. Instead of snuffalos and butcher raptors, you can now find creatures like the elephinches, truly unique looking birds with two tentacle-like appendages that can grasp food and other objects. How did something like this possibly evolve from a bill? Well, elephinches are descended from burrowers, whose bills became fleshier and more flexible to aid with rooting through the dirt for food. Over millions of years, these bills became softer and more muscular, eventually splitting into two distinct trunk-like apparatuses. And so, one of the strangest creatures on Serina emerged. The perhaps somewhat less impressive cousins of the elephinches on these islands are the snuffles. Small, soft-snouted nocturnal birds with sensitive whiskers that aid in their nighttime hunts for food. One offshoot of this group, the water snuffles, has something even stranger than whiskers sprouting from the ends of its bill: fleshy, finger-like appendages, similar in some ways to the elephinch's trunks. A really unique-looking creature. And in the midst of this incredible peak of biodiversity on the Cryan Islands, the oceans, and the mainlands, the tribbets, the terrestrial descendants of the mudwicket fishes, have in the late Thermocene become strange three-legged organisms called hoppers. The adaptation of these unique animals into land dwellers has been a true achievement, and they're now thriving in the warm temperatures. Still, the hoppers are only about the size of a rat. It would take a mass extinction for them to ever become a dominant species on Serina. Which is exactly what happened next. A rise in global temperatures, volcanic fumes, eruptions, and ocean anoxia creates a runaway effect that results in the worst mass extinction event in the moon's history. Simply called Armageddon, the end Thermocene extinction would obliterate over 99% of all life on Serina. But this cataclysm was not the end. Eventually, Armageddon would pass, and the sun would rise on the Pangeacene. It is now 10 million years after this mass extinction, and the fire and brimstone are already a distant memory for many species. In this era, all of Serina's major landmasses have come together to form a single supercontinent. The climate has somewhat stabilized, and the survivors of Armageddon are beginning to rediversify. But the inheritors of this new world are quite different from its old monarchs. If one explores the continental forests of this reborn moon, one would find far stranger life than ever before. Lumbering amongst the trees comes a terrestrial muck, a descendant of one of their smaller ancestors. These hook-clawed creatures might look odd, but they're far from the strangest new forms of life here. From the water comes a descendant of the water snuffle, one of the only species from the Cryan Islands to survive, thanks to its aquatic adaptations. The finger-like tendrils on the ends of their beaks are becoming more pronounced, and may soon become even more complex. Out of a nearby riverbank erupts a bumblet, the sole survivor out of all the vivas that for millions of years dominated the planet. It's fascinating that out of all its grand cousins, thanks to its burrowing lifestyle, the bumblet is now the sole representative of their great evolutionary line. And at the edge of the forest, a tribbet here, the much-changed descendant of the tribbets, and by extension the mudwickets, stalks for prey. They've become a muscular, dog-like carnivore with a powerful hind leg that allows them to make great lunges at prey. Once at the bottom of Serina's food chain, their time has now finally come. Over the next several million years, through the early and middle Pangaeocene, members of this group called the Cainotheres would prove to be the most successful and prominent large predators on Serina. The author writes that the predator's flexible spine, which moves in an up and down arc, works almost like a spring, collecting energy as the creature contracts its leg and releasing it as it extends, making for an efficient running gait. It's hard to imagine that these dominant, warm-blooded, furry organisms were once fish, brought in to be the canary's food source. Another descendant of the terrestrial fish has taken to the trees, becoming the somewhat alarming-looking handfish. These creatures look like a cross between a monkey, a frog, and a spider, with long, fractaline digits, well-suited to climbing and holding onto branches. Later in the Pangaeocene, descendants from the same group would even conquer the air, with the tribbats now taking to the sky alongside the birds, the first group of vertebrates on Serina to independently develop powered flight. While their wing design isn't quite as efficient as birds in the open sky, tribbats are the most common animals of the tropical forests. But the birds are not down for the count just yet. Indeed, several million years into the Pangaeocene, flying birds have managed to reach sizes never before seen in their history. These majestic giants are called archangels, the descendants of small tree-dwelling ancestors who outlasted the Thermocene extinction and then rapidly grew to sizes rivaling the largest pterosaurs. Scampering nearby on the open plains are herds of sarazels, a descendant of the same avian Armageddon survivor as the archangels, though sarazels have become swift-footed grazers. They are marked with bold, contrasting patterns of stripes and spots, which likely serve to hide their outlines when moving in large groups, just as is the case for zebra on our own planet. But the sarazel's dominance on the plains wouldn't last. In the later Pangaeocene, they'll be edged out by the circuagodonts, a highly specialized group of tribetheres that are unrecognizable compared to their fish ancestors. The circuagodonts possess specialized teeth that allow them to eat a wider variety of grasses than sarazels, allowing them to eventually usurp the sarazel's place on the plains. Indeed, beyond the Pangaeocene, it's not megafauna like the sarazels or archangels that will contribute the most to the legacy of birds on Serina. In time, the humble bumblets move above ground, becoming a group of foragers called bumble badgers. And in the game of life, they're a new player to keep an eye on. Also furthering the legacy of birds, though taking it in an admittedly strange direction, are the excellently named mittens. These descendants of the water snuffle have developed a mobile set of tentacles on their snouts, which they use to manipulate food items. The somewhat Cthulhu-looking creatures are indeed quite intelligent and are starting to use basic tools. In time, the mittens branch off into the plains-dwelling bludge birds, animals that use crude weapons to aid in hunting. These creatures are clearly fairly intelligent, perhaps even one of the most intelligent species ever to exist on Serina. However, despite appearances, they're not actually smarter than, say, crows or great apes from our own world. Indeed, to find the first true example of high intelligence on Serina, one must look elsewhere. Watching the bludge birds from the branches are fork-tailed babbling jays. Unlike the bludge bird, this small species is not extraordinary for its appearance. Furthermore, they are a very young species, having only been in existence for no more than 4,000 years. Yet babbling jays are easily the smartest creatures yet to arise on Serina. Possessing an incredible capacity for tool crafting, language, and critical thinking, jays even produce art using bark and stone, and possess verbal superstitions and a developing culture. Sadly, this brief glimmer of brilliance wouldn't last. In a relative blink of an eye, the harsh desert environment that spurred the development of their keen intellect would shift once again, and the jays would prove that no species, no matter their intelligence, is immune to extinction. Looking forwards beyond the Pangaeocene, it is neither the babbling jays nor the bludge birds that will continue to carry the torch of intelligence onwards. Instead, high intelligence will arise in some of the most unexpected species. Part 3 of this series will cover the emergence of true sapience on Serina. But for now, that's all the time we have. If you enjoyed learning about Serina, consider following and supporting Dylan Bajda using the links below. Also, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support, and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.